This video is dedicated to the dual or polar coil, which is the basic tool to solve many real and interesting problems and mainly to solve linear systems of inequations. We use both names so that here polar and dual cone are the same thing. What is the dual cone of a cone? Let us see. Imagine that you have a cone up a sub pi and that you want to obtain its dual cone, to be represented as a sub pi adding a superindex p, that is a sub pi super p. Then the dual cone is the subset of all vectors x such that the dot product of this vector by all a sub I, that is the derivatives of the cone, are less or equal to zero. This implies that we look for vectors such that when multiplied by all vectors in the cone, the resulting values are less than or equal to zero. If some of these products leads to a positive value, we immediately know that the vector does not belong to the polar cone. To visualize the concept, we give one example. Suppose that you have the green cone in the central part of the figure, which is generated by vectors a1 and a2. Then the pink cone is its dual cone, which is generated by the vectors a3 and a4. The vector a3 forms with the vector a1 an angle of 90 degrees, and a4 forms with a2 an angle of 90 degrees, represented in the figure. Then, if the angle between the vectors is greater than 90 degrees, the dot product is negative, and if it is less than 90 degrees, it is positive. Thus, we have to select vectors such that they form an angle of 90 degrees or more with all vectors in the cone, in blue. All vectors in the pink cone satisfy this condition. Thus, the dual cone of the blue cone is the pink cone in the figure, which has been obtained considering that the limit case occurs when the angle is exactly 90 degrees, that is, when the dot product is zero. It is easy to prove that the dual of the dual is the initial or primal cone. This is a useful property. Since the dual cone of a vector space is its orthogonal subspace, the dual cone extends the concept of orthogonal subspace to a more general and powerful concept. This is the polar or the dual cone, and the question we now ask ourselves is, how to obtain the dual cone of a given cone? Even though a detailed explanation will be the topic of another lesson, we want to advance some important facts. The algorithm that we will use to solve this problem was presented by Francisco Jubete and called the Gamma algorithm, and later we have improved it and optimized the way to operate it and to develop new applications. Thus, to solve the problem of the dual cone, we can give the initial cone in the form of a cone, a sub p, that is, by means of a set of generators that by non-negative linear combinations generate the cone. Or we can also give the cone in a standard form, that is, as B rho and Cp. And even the matrix B can be a matrix of basic vectors or no, and the matrix C can be a matrix of edges or not. In other words, the Jubete algorithm is able to solve the most general case, though obviously it is more convenient to work with basic vectors and edges, because calculations are reduced, because then we have less vectors to operate and the problem can be solved more quickly. To use the Jubete gamma algorithm, we need to give the initial cone as data. To this end, we use a data file with the content as indicated. This includes a matrix whose columns are the generators of the cone, and we use commas to separate the data values with no blank spaces. In the last row, separated from the matrix of generators, we include zeros or ones to indicate if the linear combinations of the column vectors above are unrestricted or they must be non-negative, that is, we indicate which column vectors generate the vector space or the cone part respectively. After executing the program, we get a set of tables, the initial table, and the tables containing the dual cons of the cons generated by the first column vector, the first two, the first three, and so on, until we obtain the final table, in which we obtain the dual of the initial cone. In each table, the columns headed by AV give the basis of the vector space part of the dual cone, and the columns headed by AW provide the edges of the acute cone part. That is, we get the cone in the standard simplified form. To illustrate, we obtain the dual of the cone H of P used to indicate how data is provided to the program, that is, with the file indicated. After execution, we get the following tables. Since we have six vector generators, we have to introduce the six vectors, one in each table and its in its first column, starting by the first table as indicated. Note that the last table does not contain this column. Thus, we get the initial table with the identity matrix inside of dimension 5 times 5, because we use vectors with dimension 5, and six more tables with the corresponding duals of the cones generated by the already introduced vectors. They correspond to tables in iterations 2 to 6, and the final table with the dual of the initial cone. Next, we calculate the scalar product of the A vectors by each column vector in the table, and write the corresponding values in the row headed T, as indicated. Next, we select the pivot column vectors with the condition of a non-null scalar product, and if that column has not been used before, with the aim of distinguishing the used column for pivoting, we label them W vectors after pivoting, so that we cannot use W vectors for pivoting. If the dot products are zero, we include the index of the A vectors in the lower part and below the corresponding vectors. For example, in the first table, we get four zero scalar products, and then we include the subindex 1 of the A vector in the T-headed row. Next, if a pivot column exists, we apply the algorithm to get the dual cone, which produces the table in iteration 2. In iterations 1, 2, 3, and 4, we have pivot columns, and we apply the corresponding procedure. However, in iterations 5 and 6, no pivot column exists, because the V columns have associated a zero scalar product. In these cases, we need to apply a different procedure to obtain the dual cones of the cones generated by the previously introduced vector generators. So, in each table, we have a dual cone. If there are V column vectors, they are the basis of the vector space part of the dual cone. If there are W vectors, they are the edges of the acute part of the corresponding dual cone. We indicate that after obtaining each table, to simplify tables, we can multiply any V column by any non-zero real number, and each W column by any non-negative real number, because these operations lead to valid bases of the vector spaces and to edges of the acute cones. This is useful and has been incorporated in the computer program, so that after each iteration, a simplification of this type is done if possible. In summary, we have obtained the duals of six cones, and the final one is the one of the initial cone. Thus, it is the initially desired dual. But we need to know that free of charge, we have got other dual cones which can be useful. In addition, the lower part of the tables provides the main facets of the initial cones, that is, those generated by the already introduced generators. This is very useful, because obtaining these facets is not an easy matter. In another video, we will show how this can be immediately applied to obtain the facets of polytopes of any dimension. As one example, since in the final table we have five W vectors, we have in each of the columns the main facets of the initial cone, generated by the A vectors with the indicated indices. You can see that in this space of dimension 5, because the A vectors have 5 components, we have 6 facets, generated 2 of them by 3 A vectors and 3 of them by 4 A vectors. The V vector is the only one that includes the 6 indexes 1 to 6. This is in fact a way of identifying the V vectors in the tables. The secondary, tertiary, etc. facets can be immediately obtained by intersections of those of higher order, as shown in other video. Since the Gamma algorithm provides the dual cone of a given cone in a standard form, because the dual of the dual is the initial cone, applying the algorithm twice is a form of obtaining the standard form of a cone. However, this can be done in a better way. Before ending this video, we saw how we calculate the dual of the dual cone, and we will see that we get the initial cone in the same form as the one given at the start, thus providing that the initial cone was already in a standard form. That is, it has no vector space part, and the supply generators were edges, with no redundant vectors. To enter the Gamma algorithm, we use the following file, with the information in our previous table, that is, the dual cone. Note that since this cone has a linear space part of dimension 1, we need to include in the last data row a 0 below the basic vector, which is the first one. Entering this data into the web page application, we get the following tables, where we can see that we have the initial plus 6 more tables. Then we can pivot in the first 5 iterations, but not in the 6th one. Finally, we see that the dual of the dual generators coincide with those we have initially, but in a different order. Since there is no V column, the vector space part does not exist. Finally, the main factors of the dual cone are the 6 ones indicated in the lower part of the final table and contain all 4 vectors. Our final example tries to identify the edges of a cone, which is graphically illustrated in the figure. Even though it is a 3-dimensional example, it is not very easy to identify its edges. In larger dimensional problems, it will be impossible to guess the edges in general cases. Here we have 7 vectors that generate a cone, and we assume that we do not know the edges of the cone. To identify them, we use our Gamma algorithm twice, as follows. First, we create the following data file, which is obtained from the graphic figure of the cone generators. Introducing this data to the computer program, we get the following tables, which show its dual cone. From the final table, in its lower part, we identify the facets of the cone, which, as it appears in the lower part of the final table, are defined by the pairs of vectors A1, A3, A2, A3, A1, A5, A2, A7, and A5, A7. Since the vectors A4 and A6 do not appear there, we can conclude that they are vectors interior to the initial cone, that is, not edges. To complete this, next we create a dual cone data file to obtain this dual, and we get this file. Introducing this data to the computer program, again, we get the following tables, which show its dual cone, that is, the initial one in a standard form. From it, we can conclude the following. The dual cone has no vector space part, and the acute cone part is generated by the 5 edges in the finite table, which correspond to the initial generators A1, A2, A3, A5, and A7. Thus, we discover again that A4 and A6 are redundant, and can be removed when generating the cone. In addition, the final table in the lower part gives the facets of dimension 2 of the dual cone, which involve all generators of the dual cone, showing that none of them is redundant. With this, we end this example, indicating that the details of how to proceed in the Gamma algorithm will be given in another video. In conclusion, we see that studying the dual cone is worthwhile, because apart from other applications to be seen in other videos, we can obtain the simplified form of a cone. It is its standard form and its facets. Finally, We invite you to see the next video, which deals with the problem of obtaining the facets of cones and polygons.